This is an audiobook of Vanu, The Search for Personal Freedom by Rayo, edited by John Fisher, published by Lumpanics Unlimited in 1983. This production is covered by a BIPCOT no government license, which allows reuse or modification by anyone except for governments or their agents. Learn more at BIPCOT.org. This book was originally transcribed by Shane Radliff of Liberty Under Attack in May of 2016. Kyle Reardon of the Last Bastille blog will read Section 1, and Shane from LUA will read Section 2. Enjoy. Introduction. In the early 1960s, a ferment began among some people who were interested in expanding personal freedom and possibly creating a truly free society, one much freer than any that exists at the present time. This ferment, heavily influenced by the writings of Ayn Rand, grew to become the modern libertarian movement. One of the earliest libertarian projects was Free Isles, which was an effort by some Southern California freedom seekers to explore the possibility of founding a libertarian new country, perhaps on an island somewhere. One of the participants in the Free Isles project was a unique man who called himself El Rey, later changed to Rayo. The Free Isles project never got beyond the talking stage. When it petered out, Rayo began looking elsewhere for ways to expand freedom, especially his own personal freedom. He decided that land mobility was a promising idea, so he moved out of his apartment into a camper mounted on a pickup truck. For several years, he lived in his camper and later at campsites deep in the mountains and forests up and down the west coast of North America. During these years, Rayo wrote about his ideas and his way of life in several small newsletters and journals. The following chapters consist of a collection of the best of these articles taken from Innovator, Free Trade, Libertarian Connection, and Vanu Life. Sources. Innovator, called Liberal Innovator during its first year, was published from February 1964 to autumn 1969, usually monthly. It was subtitled Applications, Experiments, and Advanced Developments of Liberty. Innovator is one of the leading libertarian publications of its day, even though its circulation was only about 1,000 at its peak. Free Trade was published in March 1968 to November 1969 as a supplement to Innovator, on a varying schedule, usually bimonthly. It consisted of ads and unedited letters from subscribers discussing freedom ideas and applications. Libertarian Connection began in December 1968, apparently influenced by Free Trade. LC was an open forum publication, which means each subscriber had a contractual right to submit a certain number of pages for each issue, which would be published unedited just as they were submitted. LC was printed on mimeograph machine for the first 45 of its 6 weekly issues. Then a new method of printing was introduced using photo offset with 50% reduction, very small print. After issue number 79, a new manager, non-editor, took over LC and changed its name to The Connection. TC is still being published as an open forum newsletter on a 6 weekly schedule. As of this writing, the latest issue is TC 110, which runs to 92 pages. You can get a sample issue of TC by sending $1 to Erwin S. Strauss, 9850 Fairfax Square, number 232, Fairfax, Virginia, 22031. Rayo published Vanu Life himself beginning in May 1971 until 1973 when he turned it over to another editor who continued it until November 1974. There were 17 regular issues of VL and one larger issue called a special handbook issue, all printed by photo offset with 50% reduction like the later issues of LC TC. The last few issues of VL were actually called Vanu Link, but I usually refer to them as Vanu Life to indicate that they are part of the same series. The 17 regular issues ran from 4 to 14 pages each. The special handbook issue called Vanu Life 1973 was 32 pages long, about half of it was written by Rayo. Prices. Since the following chapters were written between 1964 and 1973, the prices mentioned are very much out of date. To help you adjust the prices for the considerable price inflation we have endured since the 1960s and 70s, I have compiled the figures below. The second column of the table below comes from What Would More Inflating Mean to You, published by American Institute for Economic Research. It shows what the purchasing power of the dollar had declined to in various years based on an index of 100 for the dollar in 1939. For example, the dollar is worth 35.9 cents in 1970, which means $1 in 1970 could buy goods that cost only 35.9 cents in 1939. I calculated the third column by dividing each figure in column 2 by the 13.8 cents figure for 1982. This yields a multiplier which can be used to adjust previous year's prices to see roughly what those items cost at present 1983 prices. For example, since the multiplier in column 3 for 1967 is 3.0, an item that cost $100 in 1967 would cost about 3.0 times $100 equals $300 in 1983. When prices are mentioned in the following chapters, you can refer back to this table to find the multiplier for the year that chapter was written and adjust those prices to see what their equivalents are in 1983 dollars. Of course, the prices of some items rose more and some rose less over the years, so this will give you only a rough estimate, but perhaps it will be somewhat helpful.
Section 1. What does freedom mean? Is freedom a useful concept? Can a social environment be meaningfully described in terms of freedom? Spokesmen for the political economic status quo assert that man is, in large measure, a slave of his environment and his personal limitations, and thus is never really free. This implies that acts or threats of violence inflicted on one man by other men are no more oppressive than are the misfortunes and restrictions inflicted on man by his physical environment. That, for example, a state edict to pay taxes or be imprisoned is not fundamentally different from the biological need to obtain food or starve. If this view were correct, then freedom would be a sociological myth, and all arguments for freedom would be empty phrases. A meaningful concept of freedom cannot include immunity from natural phenomena. A man is obviously never free from the principles of gravity, nor free from the necessity of sustaining his own life, so long as he chooses to live. What is the significant difference between constraints imposed on a man by other human beings and the requirements of physical reality? Man's physical environment is mechanistic. It is not volitional. Man's ability to function within his environment is limited only by his intelligence and knowledge, and by intrinsic physical properties of the environment. Man may choose to increase his knowledge and devise ingenious ways to overcome apparent environmental constraints. And the environment continues to function in a potentially predictable manner, devoid of conscious intent. Man possesses and may use intelligence to alter his environment, but his physical environment has no intelligent purpose to oppose man. In contrast, constraints imposed on a man by other men can be the result of conscious, calculated, volitional intent. Purposeful attempts by a victim of force to regain his freedom can be opposed and negated by the purposeful counteractions of the coercers. Men bent on the forceful imposition of their demands can be a vastly more serious threat, a vastly more severe restriction on human action, than are the non-reasoning forces of nature. For this reason, freedom, defined as the absence of physical force initiated by intelligent beings, is a meaningful concept. Freedom is a vital component of human effectiveness and fulfillment. From Liberal Innovator, Volume 1, Number 4, May 1964. How to develop liberty at a profit. Initiated violence by government is the big problem facing humanity. Few libertarians will take issue. But why are efforts to achieve liberty so paltry, amateurish, and inadequate compared to efforts to solve other problems? Why must liberty be marketed so inadequately? Why is so little capital available for the development and sale of liberty? Government, much of it unnecessary and unwarranted, sees directly or indirectly about 40% of our earnings. In contrast, an insignificant fraction of our income is spent for cleaning compounds. Yet vastly more money is available for promoting new detergents than for all pro-freedom political and educational activities combined. It is therefore not surprising that new detergents are promoted incomparably more effectively. Perhaps a missing ingredient is profit motive. One observes that new detergents are merchandised by profit-seeking corporations, whereas libertarian groups, political and educational, are dependent on philanthropic contributions in fact, if not in name. Unpaid expenditure of time to promote a course or book is as much a philanthropic contribution as is monetary donation. And merely setting up an organization which is legally profit-making is no assurance of realizing profits. Can liberty be developed and marketed for a profit? Or are there crucial differences which vitiate profit potential between liberty and other products, between the elimination of systematic coercion and, say, the removal of dirt from clothes? Existing governments are invariably natural monopolies within their geographical areas. An increase in freedom, a reduction in government restrictions realized by any means short of armed insurrection, potentially benefits every individual within the nation who does not seek the unearned. The benefits of liberty accrue to the individual, whether or not he helps achieve a greater liberty. For example, if a pro-libertarian is elected president and reduces income taxes, misguided persons who bitterly oppose the man, as well as a person who did nothing, will benefit as much as those individuals who donated their time and money to elect the man. Is it surprising that the unspoken slogan of many libertarians becomes, "I'm all for greater freedom, provided somebody else does the work necessary to achieve it"? Each individual who does participate in a pro-freedom activity certainly will increase the amount of freedom, or the rate of increase of freedom, at least slightly, and will thereby derive at least a small tangible benefit. But the benefits of pro-freedom political or educational activity within a nation are diffuse. The individual within a nation receives as tangible returns only a minutely small fraction of the improvements he brings. Most pro-freedom activity is a charitable donation to unknown strangers. Are they ways for giving political partisans a self-interest in motivation? Yes, but the methods are probably not useful to libertarians. For example, instead of proposing a planned tax reduction program for all citizens, a pro-freedom candidate might propose the elimination of all taxes, but only for those individuals who contribute $100 to his campaign. Such a proposal would probably ensure defeat at the polls. Further, such an idea, if it could be implemented, would almost certainly be found unconstitutional. Ironically, the pro-collectivist candidate can and does take advantage of short-range self-interest of immoral people by promising legal plunder to special groups and plunder-supported patronage to special individuals. Consequently, pro-freedom political forces labor under what must at least be called an enormous tactical handicap. What is true for political activity is equally valid for most educational endeavors. Pro-freedom educational activities, of course, offer opportunities for tangible profit to a very few individuals, such as writers, lecturers, and professional staffers, who may be able to earn a comfortable living from their enterprises, but who could probably draw a much larger income working, say, in the advertising industry. And, besides, growth of such libertarian endeavors as bookselling, lecture circuiting, and institutional educating is, finally, vitally dependent on personal contacts by readers, followers, and students, which is largely philanthropic. The sparsity of personal tangible returns, constitutes a severe limitation on conventional political and educational activities, an enormous handicap to almost all existing pro-freedom organizations. The individual must properly live his life for his own sake, and he quite correctly devotes the major part of his life energies to those tasks which yield direct material profits. This does not mean that pro-freedom activities of the conventional sort are necessarily irrational. It does mean that such activities are largely philanthropic, little different in this respect from the Heart Foundation or the American Cancer Society. An individual can rationally participate in a philanthropic enterprise only if he judges his tangible benefits to be greater than his tangible costs. What pro-liberty activists will yield tangible as well as intangible benefits? One potentially profitable category of action is tax minimization. If the individual can reduce the taxes he pays to the government, he not only directly benefits himself, but indirectly furthers liberty by reducing the funds available to the government, funds which the government can use for vote-buying spoils schemes and propaganda in support of its collectivist policies. Unfortunately, the amount of tangible benefits which can be realized through tax minimization is rather limited unless one resorts to illegal evasion of taxes or goes on strike and lives as subsistence levels, either of which may result in disadvantages which nullify tax savings. A category of action similar to tax minimization is anti-inflation investment. Holding savings in forms such as silver coins or stocks, which have a commodity value rather than merely a fiat money value. Besides benefiting oneself, such practices effectively reduce the quantity of government-issued money in circulation and reduce the ability of the government to plunder through the inflation mechanism of debt creation. A promising new approach for developing liberty at a profit is being advanced by various groups who seek to initiate sovereignly independent, laissez-faire free ports outside of the United States. It is proposed that commercial communities be developed on land sovereignly leased or purchased from existing nations. The major attraction of a free port would be complete freedom from taxes and regulations. For a great many businesses, the disadvantages of remote location would be far outweighed by the advantages of total freedom. Unlike the utopian community in Ayn Rand's Atlas Shrugged, Random House, 1957, which symbolized a withdrawal from the existing society, a sovereign freeport would be very much a part of world commerce, though not of existing political states. The developers would not attempt to become economically self-sufficient or socially exclusive. Many of the probable industries, in fact, would involve international commerce, industries such as resorts, warehousing, import-export, security exchanges, and marine bunkering. Investors in the initial freeport development would directly realize profits through sale and lease of land. The land would appreciate in value both by virtue of being in a laissez-faire community and as a result of development. For this reason, freeport development outside the United States would attract capital much more readily than can political and educational activities within the United States. The secondary social benefits of a freeport would be impressive. Not only would the freeport provide a political economic haven for those seeking to establish a business, practice a profession, establish a private experimental community, or merely life free from state harassment, a freeport would provide a valuable demonstration, a living refutation of the myths regarding the semi-capitalism of the 19th century. To advance individual freedom, libertarians must devise unconventional approaches which utilize personal self-interest. The laissez-faire Freeport is one outstanding way to develop liberty at a profit. From Innovator, Volume 2, November 1964. Some thoughts on libertarian strategy. I have followed with interest the debate between political crusaders and self-liberators in Libertarian Connection and Free Trade. I make the following comments on terminology. Political crusaders try to categorize all non-crusaders as retreatists. The retreat concept, as set forth by Harry Brown and Don and Barbara Stevens, means disaster insurance, preparations to survive an expected future politico-economic disaster without substantially altering one's pre-disaster lifestyle. This is not the same as self-liberation. A change in lifestyle is not predicated on coming catastrophe. While a retreater and self-liberator may use some of the same techniques, their attitudes and general approaches are different. I am here concerned mainly with self-liberation. Objections of the political crusaders to self-liberation, mostly innuendos, ex cathedra pronouncements, and misrepresentations, have been refuted by me, Spring Innovator, page 7 to 47, and others. But the crusaders have consistently failed to refute or even acknowledge serious objections to any would-be libertarian political movement. I'm using political in a broad sense to include all efforts to take over, replace, or destroy an existing state through education, elections, and/or insurrections. The two most fundamental problems of any genuinely libertarian political movement are, number one, its dependency on collective incentives, and, number two, the dichotomy between means and ends. Strangely, a free enterprise economist who understands that voluntary large-scale collectivism will not work in industry believes it can work in a revolutionary movement. And strangely, a revisionist historian acquainted with many well-intentioned reform movements and revolutions, which brought forth only more tyranny, believes that political activity can bring liberty. Any realistic strategy must be premised on the real world, and explicit libertarians are a very small fraction of the population of that world. Whether this is due solely to cultural conditioning or to genetic inheritance as well, I would not care to guess. But in any case, presently and for the foreseeable future, only a relatively few people will have the intelligence, integrity, and motivation to achieve or preserve freedom. The masses have the minds of serfs, while many do not desire slavery as such. Their attitudes, customs, and reactions constitute a milieu in which coercive governments can arise and will. History provides overwhelming empirical evidence. Holbrooke made the point, July Free Trade, that the herd has never been on any side, and that the war will be between the libertarian and the statist vanguards. While correct, this is not very encouraging, for statists have positive, individualizable incentives for enslaving and plundering the herd, whereas libertarians can only have negative collective incentives for liberating the herd. Libertarians will almost inevitably lose any such contest as they have throughout history. For results of the American Revolution, read Erickson's The Decline of American Liberalism. So any talk about continent-sized free societies of whatever kind brought about by whatever means is strictly utopian. Such talk may be a pleasant diversion and may help convert the few who have libertarian potential. But in the real world, liberty will be limited for a long time to come to self-liberated individuals and, perhaps, libertarian mini-cultures and freeports. But this is not the grounds for pessimism or defeatism. One can forget about the herd and become free once he exorcises the collectivist spooks from his head. But while I reject political crusading as a strategy, this does not mean I shun active resistance as a tactic. While seizing or destroying a state, even if possible, is usually worse than useless, selective counterattacks may have value. In many ways, a bureaucratic apparatus is like a simple biological organism. Pavlovian psychology is applicable. Cause a certain behavior, such as molesting a libertarian, to be painful, and an agency will learn not to do it. At first thought, it seems that any conflict between an individual libertarian and a large state is hopelessly one-sided, but this need not be the case so long as the libertarian sticks to self-liberation and doesn't try to beat the statists at their own games. While the state has much greater resources, it is a correspondingly larger target. The libertarian can hide or remain anonymous, striking out a time and a place, and in a manner of his own choosing. The state cannot. Contemporary technology, if anything, favors the individual. Anyone sufficiently determined can build his own nuclear weapon, or more appropriate for libertarians, psychedelic arsenal. The self-liberator has tactical advantages over a would-be insurrectionist of any brand. The political crusader, who wants to take over or destroy a state, seriously threatens the rulers and will bring strong countermeasures. But the libertarian who is satisfied to coexist in protracted conflict with the state is merely an annoyance. The more astute ruler is aware, as is the libertarian, that most people are sheep and will remain sheep, no matter how the libertarian lives. Of course, the statist would still rather squash the libertarian if this were easy. So libertarian tactics must be such as to make counterattacks ineffective and prohibitively costly. One simple retaliatory mechanism is available right now to many libertarians. An individual puts part of his savings in a cash or Swiss account accessible to a friend and makes the following agreement. If he is arrested, so long as he remains incarcerated, his friend each month withdraws a certain sum and spends this for whatever will cause the offending governmental agency maximum annoyance and disability. If the individual should be executed, all of his earmarked savings are so expended. This friend is contractually obliged to carry through the retaliation, even if the victim cannot stop it while incarcerated. This prevents possible intimidation should the agreement be found out. This agreement is presumably kept secret. The agency and the individual bureaucrats would, however, be told for what they were being punished. It would be pointed out their victim was not only minding his own business, but was acting in accordance with clear-cut moral principles, that he was not merely a common criminal, one of the herd gone astray. Through such a retaliatory arrangement, the victim not only increases chances for release, but gains a certain satisfaction. So long as he remains in jail, what better use could he make of his savings? Whether or not such retaliation should be limited to legal activities is beyond the scope of this letter. Libertarians are devising many clever schemes for fouling up the state. But rather than applying these erratically and willy-nilly, I suggest they be reserved for well-defined, limited objectives beneficial to libertarians. As retaliative capabilities grow, libertarians may be able to realize the de facto immunity from conscription, social security, travel regulations, and other especially onerous violations of liberty. Responding to Carl Hess's remark, Libertarian Connection number 6, number 1, I would not cooperate with the police in the apprehension of a libertarian revolutionist. Anyone who did would be aiding the initiation of force and would himself become fair game. Number 2, I would be happy to shelter any fairly rational libertarian revolutionist fleeing a state agent, and, as suggested above, I might be able to offer him a more rewarding employment of his skills. There is another area for mutual interest or alliance, ideological education. The revolutionary seeks recruits, and self-liberator seeks associates and underground traders. A specialist in educational services can profitably serve both. A note to fellow self-liberators on this. Now that several good sources of educational services exist, I suggest a boycott of organizations which are knee-jerk hostile to self-liberation. This is not to suggest that educators must themselves opt out or endorse any particular approach, but it is in our self-interest to reserve trade and contributions for groups which, number one, avoid categorical condemnation of self-liberation, and number two, are open to advertisements of self-liberational media and ventures. From Free Trade, a Supplement to Innovator, November 1969. Some Thoughts on Libertarian Strategy, Part 2. Now that a collective movementism, also called bullshit, libertarianism, and political crusading, has been discredited as a liberation strategy, it is appropriate to re-examine strategies which treat freedom as an individually achievable way of life and marketable commodity. I discern 5 general means of protection against coercion, initiated force. Defense, deterrence, mobility, deception, and concealment. Any system for achieving, preserving liberty will involve one more of these. Defense. Defense, as a major element of protection, became ineffective with the invention of explosives capable of demolishing castle walls. Large-scale defense became even more ineffective, and the state became obsolete as a protection organization with the invention of nuclear weapons. Some defense means, firearms, karate, guard dogs, chemical, disablements, etc., these are also kinds of deterrence, remain of some value against unorganized predators. Deterrence. A system relying mainly on deterrence tends to be unstable and result in mutual destruction, unprofitable to all parties. Its instability stems from the advantages of landing the first blow. One example is the balance of terror among nuclear weapon states, which may break down at any time with catastrophic results. Another more relevant to us might be a band which camps openly, allows their location to become public knowledge in the national forests, and tries to keep the bludgies, pigs, at bay by threatening to burn the woods. This might work for a while, but would result sooner or later, I suspect, in burned forests and imprisoned band members. As black militants have shown, deterrence is valuable, perhaps necessary, but only as a supplement to other protection means. Mobility. Mobility developed to a logical and useful extreme becomes international mobility or country shopping. International mobility may be implemented by living aboard a yacht or out of a suitcase. Of course, the country shopper does not achieve freedom from the coercive laws of states he visits. He merely maximizes his legal privilege, limiting his activities in each country to what is relatively unmolested there. In one sense, he is more law-abiding than the natives in a port of call, since he doesn't know the local territory, law enforcement practices and subterfuges as well. Indirect effects of increasing international mobility include, on one hand, a reduction of harassment by some small states which compete for the trade. On the other hand, intimidation of those states by larger powers, mainly the US and the USSR, intends on keeping their populace subjected. Ultimately, the country shopper's freedom depends on the deterrence defense capability of his ports of call, as well as his ability to move from one to another. Deception. Some libertarians hope to achieve freedom principally through deception. They propose to live conventionally in outward appearance while secretly conducting black gray market trade, designing protection devices useful mainly against unorganized criminals, and enjoying illicit forms of recreation. I have seen many attempted free market enterprises around Los Angeles during the past 6 years, and, almost without exception, these have failed for lack of interest support or have been co-opted into something subservient to the state. Telephone some successful private protection service and ask for help when you are molested by the big criminals. This lack of interest support, the psychological paralysis afflicting libertarians, of which Natalie Hall has written so well, stems in part, I think, from almost continual vulnerability. Most debilitating is the absence of a secure home or base, mobile and stationary, to which one can retire to relax, eat, think, and recreate. Conventional living libertarians seem even more prone to psychoparalysis than the population at large, no doubt because they are more aware of the dangers. Of course, psychoparalysis is a subconscious evaluation. There need not be a conscious appraisal. One can practice deception 5 or 10% of the time, I think, without long-term ill effects. But the conventionally living libertarian must remain on guard, must act the serf, almost constantly, day and night. Bludgies prefer the witching hours for premeditated arrests. Even if the deceptionist escapes the cruder forms of harassment, he spends his life surrounded by a largely hostile creature, bombarded by value expressions counter to his own. The predictable results are neuroses and or loss of convictions. One tends to become what he pretends to be. How many of the libertarians of even 5 years ago, who stayed in serfdom, are still active, rational, libertarian? Clandestine free market enterprise with the development of specialized skills will greatly enhance liberation. But this will flourish, I think, only among people who have already achieved a large degree of personal liberation. Concealment. Liberation based exclusively on concealment amounts to two-directional isolation. In a complete absence of communication, trade with the outside world, while possible in the short term, would lead to primitivism and probably eventually to breakdown of isolation and increased vulnerability. Suppose, for example, that 100 years ago some small band had gone into seclusion, taking with them a good selection of skills, equipment, and reference books of their era. Would their descendants now be capable of understanding and developing counter-stratagems to aircraft spotting, heat detectors, nuclear fallout, strategy for personal freedom. An optimally liberated lifestyle must involve a sort of one-directional isolation. The liberator maintains his access to their open but not free trading centers while denying them access to his home. This requires a skillful blend of concealment and deception, plus perhaps elements of mobility and deterrence. A free man obtains information, techniques, key equipment, and supplies out of the servile society, exporting labor or products in return. And during import-export activities, he practices deception, perhaps carries a driver's license, genuine or faked, perhaps pays some sales taxes he cannot conveniently avoid. But the free man's home base is physically concealed. There he spends most of his time. There he may sleep, imbibe, love, design, build trade with fellow freemen, and raise children in relative safety from the savages of state. A free man's home must be a figurative castle. In one sense, such a free man cannot be completely free, since his import-export is restricted. Neither would be a resident of a utopian free country who traded with someone in Russia or America. Import-export is easier for extraterritorial freemen than for residents of another country, since controlling millions of square miles of interior is vastly more difficult than thousands of linear miles of border. In either case, with growth, import-export becomes relatively smaller and more in the hands of specialists at border crossing. The liberated home free man, unlike the conventionally living libertarian, can segregate import-export from the rest of his life, essential for development of durable, growing, joyous, free mini-cultures. From Libertarian Connection number 14, October 7th, 1970. Some Thoughts on Libertarian Strategy, Part 3. What is freedom? A symptom, and perhaps one of the cause of psychoparalysis, is the vague and evasive meanings given to freedom. Some libertarians consider freedom to be loosely synonymous with opportunity, choice, or capability. This is popular among those who wish to pretend that they are maximizing freedom while they remain very much enslaved. Most residents of the Soviet Union are thus freer than a family pioneering on a remote island. Such a definition merely clouds. It is better to say opportunity when one means opportunity. Others equate freedom with social morality, the non-coercive behavior of others. They assert that freedom can only be bestowed by others, not achieved for oneself. That freedom cannot be achieved in defiance of threats, since the very act of defiance represents a departure from what one's behavior would otherwise be, and is thus unfree. This definition also serves as an alibi for servitude. What is a workable concept of freedom? I suggest, freedom is invulnerability to coercion, coercion being physical violence initiated by other volitional beings. This definition does not mention threat of coercion. Any psychopath can utter threats against the universe. Threats are taken seriously only when readily implementable, which comes back to vulnerability. Freedom is only one kind of invulnerability. Others include immunity, invulnerability to a species of harmful microorganisms, invulnerability to harmful weather. one who continues in a vulnerable lifestyle and then complains when he is plundered, is somewhat like a West Indies resident who builds a flimsy house and then blames the next hurricane for demolishing it. Certainly, people are to blame when they inflict coercion, but merely blaming them does not bring liberty. The self-responsible person builds a home which can withstand likely storms, and develops a way of life not vulnerable to likely attempts at predation. No one claims that freedom is a summum bonum, note the highest good introduced by Cicero. To achieve freedom, one has to forego some opportunities and satisfactions while gaining others. How much freedom? As Lee and Skye mentioned, freedom is not a monolithic entity. There are various degrees, but not all degrees are necessarily viable. For most people, I suspect that choice is between predominantly servile, vulnerable lifestyles and predominantly liberated, invulnerable lifestyles. If satisfaction could be plotted with respect to freedom for a large number of people, I think the graph would have a low peak of relative satisfaction around 5 to 10% freedom, a higher peak around 90 to 95% freedom, and a wide depression in between. The lower maximum is exemplified in contemporary society by many a successful middle American. He lives conventionally, but takes advantage of some of the easier, more obvious loopholes. He pays income taxes, but hires a tax accountant to maximize deductions. He registers for the draft, but goes to college in hope of being made a technician instead of a target. His mental state is one of controlled schizophrenia. He believes most of the statist myths in which he was indoctrinated, yet maintains a modicum of skepticism. He goes to church, or at least accepts their standard of morality, but is not above having a drink at a nude bar. He is largely rational in his work, but keeps his rationality compartmented. He does not, dares not, critically examine his life as a whole. Although self-maintained schizophrenia leads to unhealthy and unhappy complications, on the whole, the opportunistic serf may have it better than his more consistent, more gullible, less self-motivated brother who is drafted and becomes a target, and a paraplegic rotting in a VA hospital, struggling along in a low-paying, high-tax job with a load of installment debts. But the opportunistic serf is probably also more contented than the nonconformist, who tried to be free in some things while remained servile in overall living pattern. One who is half free and half serf dwells in a psychological no man's land. He knows too much and thinks too independently to play servile status games with conviction and success, yet remains too immersed in and influenced by that culture to achieve success, satisfaction on his own terms. This includes many, not all, bohemians, adventurers, black market entrepreneurs, religious cultural minorities, and radicals of all sorts. A half-and-half lifestyle tends to be unstable. Some go on to more complete liberation. Some drift back into, at first, outward conformity, then acceptance of servile norms. Some end in psychosis or early death. The higher maximum of satisfaction is attained by someone with a liberated home-based plus some import-export with the servile society. For him, contact with the state is an occasional annoyance and danger, not a big part of his life. Thus, he can avoid the psychological paralysis that afflicts so many nonconformists. Compared to the opportunistic serf, he may enjoy somewhat fewer conveniences at present, but is happier overall. On the other hand, he has more than someone living in the primitive isolation presently required for 100% freedom. Liberty or servitude or neurosis? Whether one will be happier as a free man or as a slave partly depends on the individual. But this choice is not open to most libertarians. Relative contentment in servitude is possible only for those who believe in it. Most libertarians are too independent and well-informed. For libertarians, the choice is between freedom and neurosis. What become of those libertarians of 5 years ago who gave up or never tried achieving personal liberty? Of people I knew, one is now a Catholic. Another is a Mormon. Another committed himself to a mental hospital. Many are occupied with chronic ailments. Freedom for what? That is up to you, as Lee and Sky suggested. But in the immediate future, I think most liberationists will include freedom to pioneer in freedom, i.e., freedom to make a career of liberation. At present, there are no ways of self-liberation which are both easy and highly effective. Opt-out will become easier as more do it and develop techniques, but right now, effective liberation requires so much of one's time and resources that one who does it will probably make it his main career, eventually developing services for sale. Liberation is a many-splendored thing. There are various ways to do it, and a variety of physical and mental activities involved. Liberation draws on a wide range of skills and offers many satisfactions. To some, opting out evokes images of gathering berries in a far-off wilderness. Liberation does seem to be easier in uninhabited areas. At least is a do-it-yourself thing, which it necessarily is for the first pioneers. But it is also possible in large cities. Imagine, for example, an old expensive building, which appears to be only a private club, but which conceals an entranceway to apartments and workshops tunneled underneath. Freedom does indeed need more full-time professionals, not collective movement preachers seeking a coterie of followers, but explorers, inventors, developers of liberated lifeways. From Libertarian Connection number 15, November 17th, 1970. Thoughts on Freedom Strategy, Part 4, Revised. Freedom Terminology. In Strategy Part 3, I defined freedom as invulnerability to coercion. But this definition goes contrary to traditional usage. Funk and Vognall's Standard College Dictionary 68 gives the clearest definitions and differentiations I have seen. Quote, freedom, liberty, and license refer to the right or opportunity to do as one pleases. Freedom is the widest term, suggesting complete absence of restraint. Liberty is a measure of freedom within restraints, granted by or as through by a sovereign power. License is an exemption from restraint granted to one person but not to another. Close quote. Apparently, no English word exists for vulnerability to coercion. Sovereignty comes close, but it is usually applied to states and implies not merely self-defense capability, but power over others. This is not surprising since the very concept of invulnerability to coercion of individuals and non-coercive groups is relatively new at least in European cultures. The traditional attitude is, rule or be ruled. There are no alternatives. Roberta and Tom of Preform have suggested VANU, which is a contraction of voluntary and not vulnerable. VANU is phonetically distinctive. The closest words in major languages are the German von, of about, the French vont, travel via, and Spanish bono, bond, script, voucher, none of which means conflict. Forms of VANU and the corresponding forms of liberty and freedom are the condition of invulnerability to coercion is VANU. The condition of the general exemption from coercion is liberty. The condition of the absence of coercion is freedom. The action of achieving the invulnerability to coercion is VANU. The action of achieving the general exemption from coercion is liberate. And the action of achieving the absence of coercion is free. The quality of invulnerability to coercion is VANU. The quality of the general exemption from coercion is liberated. The quality of the absence of coercion is free. The comparatively more invulnerability to coercion is VANU-er. The comparatively more absence of coercion is freer. The process of achieving the invulnerability to coercion is VANUENS. The process of achieving the general exemption from coercion is liberation. The process of achieving the absence of coercion is freeing. One who has the invulnerability to coercion is a VANUAN. The one who has the absence of coercion is a free man. One who advocates the invulnerability to coercion is a VANUIST. One who advocates the general exemption from coercion is a libertarian. The advocacy of the invulnerability to coercion is VANUISM. The advocacy of the general exemption from coercion is libertarianism. The place or situation of the invulnerability to coercion is VANUUM. The place or situation of the absence of coercion is a freehold. The art of achieving the invulnerability to coercion is VANUMI, and one who is skilled at the invulnerability to coercion is a VANUMER, and finally, one who is skilled at the general exemption from coercion is a liberator. Of course, for all of these, there are degrees. Freedom is usually a relative absence of coercion or of the effects of coercion. Rarely is there no possibility of coercion. Coercion means physical attack, initiated force, against a volitional being or against his non-coercively acquired possessions by another volitional being. VANU or liberty? VANU and liberty intergrade, as do almost all concepts in the humanities. Someone who builds his own impregnable island is achieving VANU. But what about his tenant who subcontracts protection? Perhaps the tenant is considered VANU as long as he remains able to pick and choose, maintains a high degree of mobility. But if he becomes quite dependent for protection, he only enjoys liberty with respect to his protector, although VANU with respect to outsiders. How about someone working as an independent contractor rather than as an employee in America to avoid tax withholding? Superficially, he seems to depend on legal loopholes, liberty. But tax withholding from independent contractors would be difficult to enforce, so he enjoys VANU too. two confidants who trade in secret are clearly Vanu. On the other hand, employment with a non-profit corporation, which presently is required to collect social insecurity taxes, is only a use of liberty. Is liberty undesirable? Liberty depends on laws and their interpretations, and so is easily destroyed. Vanu, while not necessarily illegal, depends on reality, not legality, and so is more durable. Vanu and liberty interact in various ways. Achievement of Vanu tends to increase liberty also. For example, the unenforceability of alcohol prohibition was a major incentive for its repeal. Vanu also fosters other Vanu. For instance, with development of a relatively invulnerable home base, Vanuum, one has more capability and confidence to engage in black market trade. Large-scale use of liberty, on the other hand, tends to reduce liberty. For example, the many men who remained in college to avoid conscription prompted circumscribing of college exemptions. A large degree of liberty, long continued, reduces Vanu. In the 30s, the American government was able to confiscate much of the gold, mainly because of its long tradition of comparative liberty and relatively stable currency. Most American residents trusted it and were unprepared to protect themselves from it. Similar confiscations in other countries were not as successful, and American Indians were ill-prepared to defend themselves against the highly organized forms of coercion introduced from Europe. I suspect that any kind of liberated society is inherently unstable. In the general absence of institutionalized coercion, people will lose self-protection capabilities and become very vulnerable to institutionalized coercion, providing fertile ground for growth of new and, for a while, especially vicious states. I doubt that products and services for protection against unorganized coercers would prevent this. A good mousetrap will not stop even a small bear, nor will immunity to smallpox keep one from getting rabies. In a sense, states may be necessary evils, necessary not to provide highways, mail delivery, or other real services, but to stimulate development, maintenance of anti-state protection capabilities. A state can be truly limited only by Vanu. Its inability to impose servitude and collect taxes beyond a certain amount, not by liberty, such as constitutional checks or a permissive king. A state which doesn't plunder as much as is possible within its social technological environment, or which doesn't use the plunder effectively to perpetuate its power, will tend to be replaced through political evolution, revolution, or foreign conquest by one which does. This is one of the reasons why political crusades to repeal coercive laws or have them ruled unconstitutional are a waste of effort, or worse. This is a gloomy evaluation only for those who seek to evade responsibility for their own freedom. I am optimistic about prospects for increasing Vanu. Vanu is yours for the making. From Vanu Life Number 1, May 1971, which is a revised version of the original that appeared in Libertarian Connection Number 17, February 10th, 1971. Some Thoughts on Freedom Strategy, Part 5. Freedom Through Wealth? Some have said that the best way to achieve personal freedom is to first become wealthy. Here are some contrary points. Someone pursuing wealth tends to get caught up in associated status games and neglect his real objective. Psychological paralysis sets in. Of freedom seekers I have known who try to get rich, most have not been successful, perhaps because they know too much to play the games with the same dedication and intensity as do the middle American strivers. The few wealthy libertarians of who I know first became wealthy, then libertarian. One is more apt to be successful, and perhaps even get rich, doing something he enjoys doing, which he can do without contradicting his values, than he is doing supposedly high-income activities which he doesn't enjoy. There are formidable and increasing hazards to preserving large wealth once earned. Access to Swiss banks largely depends on government-controlled mails, telecommunication, and air transport. Cacheting large amounts of silver is arduous and time-consuming. $50,000 buys a ton of it. Also, the value of precious metals partly depends on industrial uses, and industry may not continue at present levels. Personally consumable supplies, such as food staples, are the best form of saving. But storage and rotation of more than a few thousand dollars worth is formidable. At present, there is relatively little Vanu to be purchased. It's mostly do-it-yourself. Most high-income professions are narrowly specialized, dependent upon an economy of tens of millions of people. But only a relatively few people, thousands at most, are apt to Vanu themselves in the foreseeable future. The demand in a small market is for broad skills. Most of the relatively free people in North America today have relatively low incomes. Hippies, hobos, some Indians, some blacks. Historically, Jews have been more successful than gypsies at surviving and maintaining heterodox cultures, despite their greater emphasis on wealth. For what it's worth, gypsies have enjoyed better public relations. The emerging Vanu mini-cultures will probably be more tribal than capitalistic in form. Invulnerability precludes large open markets. There are already millions of people striving for wealth by non-Vanu means. So let us develop Vanu techniques and products to sell them. Personal experience. I have only moderate savings. I'm not wealthy by most standards. By my achievement of Vanu has been limited much more by time and personal skills than by money. There are many products and services which I could and would purchase if they were available. They aren't. Of course, someone already into a skill or business whereby they can earn much money easily may well be advised to keep at it for a few years and build a nest egg. But for most Vanuists, I don't think wealth is worth much effort. From Vanu Life Number 2, July 1971. Thoughts on Freedom Strategy. Vanu Activity Trade-Off. Occasionally, especially when some project isn't going too well, I ask myself, can G and I achieve enough Vanu for Vanu to be attractive on more than an experimental basis? Or have we reached a point of diminishing returns beyond which a vast effort will yield only a small improvement? To conceptualize this better, I made the following graph. The vertical axis represents Vanu, expressed in terms of mean time to harassment, MTH. Each vertical unit is approximately a 10 times increase in MTH. The horizontal axis represents amount of activity, also difficulty of concealment. The units are summer survival, tent and bedding sufficient for sleeping, eating, and reading, occupants are one or two able-bodied adults. The occupants hole up, eat only stored food. The occupants come and go, not oftener than once a season. Several months' supply of food is on hand. All weather survival. Shelter adequate for survival, not always comfortable nor convenient the year round. Maintenance and trips are during good weather. Only sedentary activities and minimal housekeeping are done during cold, wet weather. A several year supply of food is on hand. There is no foraging. Occupants are able-bodied adults who come and go not oftener than four times a year. Comfortable home. Size and amenities are comparable to a small apartment or motorhome. There is one small family which may include small children or a non-able-bodied person. The people come and go not oftener than once a month. There is some foraging, hunting, and grow holes, but they live mostly on stores. They have no export products except possibly writing or art. Small workshop or laboratory. 400 square foot floor space. Electric power from water, sun, or wind, and or considerable cryptoculture. Frequency of communication to outside at least weekly. Transportation at least monthly. Export products may include research development, fabrication of small special purpose devices. One family, perhaps large, per site. Small manufacturing. Of items with high value to weight ratios. Aggregate floor space is 1,500 square feet, maybe several separate units. Communication with outside comparable to telephone, telefax. Transportation at least weekly. Considerable export and or purchases of most food. More than one family involved, perhaps two dozen people. Light industry. Many products possible. Also, heavy fabrication for local use, daily transportation, extensive outside commerce, up to several hundred people, heavy industry and or communication commerce center, up to 40,000 people. Narrator's note. The graph from the book is included in the downloadable PDF. There is nothing immutable about this clustering of activities. Thus, someone with only summer survival might have a clandestine radio link comparable to a telephone, while a group capable of manufacturing might still import almost all food. But I have attempted to cluster together activities, which seem to be comparably difficult to conceal, with each unit representing a 10 times increase in difficulty of concealment. Thus, a camp and supplies sufficient for summer survival can be easily hidden, whereas concealing a heavy industry, such as a conventional steel mill, would be extraordinarily difficult. Other levels of activity are intermediate in difficulty and concealment. Within the shaded area, Vanu is not likely worthwhile, i.e., the total cost of being Vanu will usually exceed the total benefits. The boundary between the viable and non-viable situations slopes downwards to the left, at least under present conditions. This is because, number one, the lower levels of activity require much less equipment, and thus a higher probability of confiscation is acceptable. Number two, the lower levels of activity are less suspicious and thus unlikely to lead to serious loss, even if discovered. Thus, a Vanuan with only a summer camp will not look or act much differently than someone on vacation and is unlikely to arouse suspicion if discovered. At most, he will be ordered to move, whereas a factory found deep in the woods or otherwise hidden, will almost certainly be the subject of an intense investigation. Even if the operators elude capture, the equipment will most likely be confiscated. Almost certainly, the factory will no longer be able to operate. If 3 years are the estimated time to amortize the initial cost of a factory, typical, the factory would not be built if estimated MTH is less than that. Exceptions involve illegal products with no non-VANU competitors, such as drugs, and with a very high profit margin and a correspondingly short time to amortize equipment costs. The diagonal lines represent levels of capability one order of magnitude, 10 times apart. 6 years ago, when I was becoming seriously interested in VANU but had little experience, my competence was roughly represented by line A. 3 years ago, after experience with living in a van, competence had increased to line B. Today, our competence level is approximated by C. Thus, at present, we can choose among the following: a small tent, adequate for summer only, in a remote place with 100 years MTH, a larger tent and more equipment and supplies in a place with year-round access, and a 10-year MTH. The larger tent is also more visible. When we want a home with amenities comparable to a city apartment, we must move back to the van, and the best we have been able to do with it is 1 or 2 year MTH. If I needed a year around workshop right now, I'd have to rent space in a conventional building somewhere. Choosing a good situation and taking responsible care, chances are I could operate for a month before some bludgy came around and asked to see my licenses, etc. With our present capability, line C, we really aren't able to enjoy a comfortable home the year around and be VANU. The price of living in a van is some submission to the bludgies. Maintaining a driver's license, paying attention to the legalities of parking in a particular area, etc. With the van, we are, in large part, enjoying liberty, legal interstices, not VANU. And laws and their interpretations often change. So long as we have C-level capability, we can trade off between increasing VANU and increasing activity. But increasing both requires more capability. C-level VANU is attractive, except in a disaster survival situation, only to experimenters in VANU, pioneers, who are interested in VANU for its own sake. We are somewhat analogous to experimenters with aircraft before 1910. These people built and flew aircraft, or tried to, not to get somewhere faster — trains were faster than the first experimental planes — nor even for aerial observation — balloons were more reliable — but simply to fly. Of course, they anticipated future uses, but these would be profitable only after considerable experimentation and improvement. Someone would have been ill-advised to build a plane in 1910 in order to, at that time, travel more quickly between LA and New York. Similarly, our present capability at VANU has limited usefulness. Most people prefer a comfortable home that is relatively non-VANU to Spartan survival with relative VANU. We probably would too, except that, number one, we believe we can increase our capabilities as we gain experience to where we enjoy VANU and comfort year-round. Number two, experimenting with VANU is, for us, an adventure, fun. A minimum of D-level capability is necessary for VANU to be attractive to many people other than experimenters. E-level is probably minimum for development of much of an alternative economy worthy of the name. How easily, quickly, can we increase our capability by another order of magnitude or two? It is tempting to project past progress and assume we will keep advancing one level every 3 years. On the other hand, we might be at a point of diminishing returns. My present expectations are that G and I can progress to level D primarily by refining present techniques, living mostly above ground, and importing most supplies. Progressing beyond D will probably require fully underground shelters and new access techniques. I'm more optimistic now, March 1973, than when I wrote this, November 1972. At midwinter, our Plinu structure was doing well, and I've conceptualized lifestyles which ease interface problems. Of course, during the past 6 years, we've made plenty of mistakes which slowed us down. There was no one we knew of to teach us, so there was much trial and error. Today, we could probably guide an inexperienced but highly motivated person, what I was 6 years ago, to our present level in a year or less. But we aren't especially interested in doing so until we reach level D. Level C is not attractive enough to justify a recruiting training effort. Vonnegut disagree about whether one should first see greater activity or greater MTH. Some believe that the neophyte should first try to build up a large and profitable but non-Vonnu conventional business, then attempt to Vonnu it. Evidence is inconclusive, but I believe the opposite approach is much more promising. Become Vonnu at a relatively low level of activity, then attempt to increase activity while maintaining or increasing Vonnu. Points. The more people involved and the more interactions with that society, the more difficult any change of lifestyle. A non-Vonnu enterprise is apt to have little in common with a Vonnu enterprise. Experience gained during the former will probably not be particularly helpful when doing the latter. Concealment is not the only means of being Vonnu. There is also deterrence and mobility. But someone who employs deterrence without concealment is essentially just a would-be rival state. Mobility is valuable only in conjunction with some kind of concealment or deception. If one can be easily traced and identified wherever he goes, nothing is gained by moving. To some, deception, concealment, seems so difficult or unpleasant that they opt instead for liberance, playing legal interstices, while remaining otherwise conventional and visible. For myself, I'm not especially interested in liberance, partially because millions of people are already playing those games for all they are worth. I don't believe I could come up with gimmicks much better than what thousands of tax lawyers, accountants, draft advisors, etc. are doing. And legal interstices are transitory. As quickly as many people discover a dodge, the bludgies move in to close it. Of course, a particular Vonnu way may not offer permanent security either. There will be new detection and counter-detection techniques. But once Vonnuans get below the noise level of environmental change caused by animals, weather, and or non-Vonnuans, the bludgies and their detectives will be at the point of diminishing returns. In the short term, certain forms of liberance have their attractions and are worth using. But I believe Vonnu has great long-range potential. From Vonnu Life, number 12, May 1973. Thoughts on Freedom Strategy, Utopias. This is partly in response to the ongoing debate between advocates of limited government and anarcho-capitalism. Both limited government libertarians, LG, and anarcho-capitalists, AC, believe in Deus ex machina. Note, this means God from the machine, which will keep their idealized open market capitalism pure. For LG, the Deus ex machina is a constitutional government which has powerful military police forces to discourage foreign and domestic aggressors, yet which somehow abstains from harassing the peaceful. For the AC, the Deus Ex Machina consists of various protection agencies and insurance companies, which remain peacefully competitive and cooperative on the whole, rather than fighting each other, forcing people to do business with them, staking out territories, and becoming states. Both hypothetical systems are contrary to historical experience. Power corrupts sooner or later. State functionaries do what they can physically get away with, regardless of what is written into a constitution. A constitution can be amended, suspended, reinterpreted, or simply ignored. And on the rare occasions when sovereignly independent military forces have occupied the same territory, the result was not competition in protection, but civil war terminating in one or more territorial states. Many AC seem to believe in word magic. If independent forces are called protection agencies and insurance companies, they will somehow abstain from doing the dastardly things which states will do. How insurance companies, for example, behave in that society as organizations subordinate to the state is not necessarily how they would develop if independent of the state. Achieving freedom and preserving freedom are really the same thing. States can be thought of as bad protection agencies or whatever. But most LG and AC try to separate the problem of achieving utopia from that of preserving utopia once achieved. Few LG are seriously running for legislatures other than for publicity or testing the constitutionality of laws. Even fewer AC are attempting to organize protection agencies capable of defying existing states. Instead, to achieve their utopias, both LG and AC invoke another, higher-order Deus Ex Machina, a cultural revolution, a fundamental change in the world views, ethical values, political attitudes of most people. Certainly, popular attitudes can and do change, and can and do affect political systems. But LG and AC err in thinking of popular attitudes as something independent of, and antecedent to, a political economic system. A person's world views depend in large part on the opportunities and problems he perceives for himself, so long as he feels subject to the state and powerless to change it, he will rationalize that the state is really necessary if not good, and will reject out-of-hand arguments to the contrary. I have come to question not only the LG and AC approaches to the problem of institutionalized coercion, but their ideal as well, open market capitalism, which is not what is commonly called capitalism in that society. Even if pure open market capitalism were achieved through some fortuitous circumstances, I believe it would be hopelessly vulnerable both to outside enemies and inside power seekers. U.S. economic and political history from about 1880 through 1910 comes close to being an example of the decay of capitalism by internal forces. Reference: Kolko's The Triumph of Conservatism. During that period, there was considerable economic freedom and consequently relatively little stability of wealth. From shirt sleeves to shirt sleeves in three generations was typical. Large, long-established companies were often cut down in a few years by newer, smaller, more capable competitors. There were no safe investments in which playboy heirs could multiply their wealth while concentrating on high society games. The old rich watched in dismay as new rich, still with lower class manners and speech, enjoy the trappings of wealth. It is no accident that many socialists were the no longer very wealthy offspring of wealthy families. And it is no accident that many large industrialists were instrumental in obtaining government regulation of their industries. The supposed purpose of the regulation was to protect the public from big business, and this served to co-opt most of the reformers of that era into supporting the legislation. But the actual result of regulatory laws was to protect established companies from new competition. There already existed a central government for the capitalists to manipulate and expand. But some large companies also hired private thugs to harass competitors and unions. If there hadn't been a state, it is difficult to believe that these forces would not have evolved into states. Given pre-industrial technology, especially the communication and transportation, which existed at the beginning of the capitalist era, open market enterprise, even to the limited extent it was able to develop under state controls, was probably the most efficient way of producing, marketing things. Given the vastly different capabilities today, I wonder if this is still true. Comparing problems of open, publicly displayed market and VANU clandestine market. An open market is subject to state restrictions and taxes, if any, whereas a VANU market can largely avoid them. On the other hand, an open market can advertise openly, produce in large quantity, and sell through a relatively few middlemen, whereas VANU marketing must be by word of mouth and requires either decentralized small-scale production or many middlemen. In the recent past, VANU marketing has been limited mostly to products and services which, number one, can only be produced locally on a small scale, such as lawn mowing, auto repairing, hair cutting, or number two, are illegal. Products for which both approaches are competitive indicate the comparative costs of open and VANU marketing at a given time and place, for example, alcoholic beverages. In the future, I expect more and more automatization of word-of-mouth communication and middlemen functions, greatly increasing speed and security at reducing costs. The newer electronic technology, integrated circuits, is greatly reducing the time, cost of coding, and interpreting data. It is also increasing the ability of snoopers to snoop and correlate their findings, but not in proportion. For example, a relatively small, cheap device can encipher data beyond the ability of any conceivable computer to break in 1,000 years, or even to identify as a cipher. And soon there will be inexpensive radio systems capable of relaying data in ways not traceable by 100 FCCs. Here is how one such system might operate. To buy or sell something, I type or speak an inquiry, order, or offer into my Secure Communicator, SC. My SC enciphers my message and transmits it to SCs of a few individuals I know and trust, which in turn they automatically re-encipher and relay it in microseconds to SCs of people they trust, etc. In this way, my message can quickly reach the SCs of a very large number of people. Someone who is selling what I'm buying has keyed his SC to watch for messages concerning that product. When my message reaches it, it deciphers and notifies its owner. He and I then converse, almost as easily as by telephone telefax, but without having any idea who or where the other person is. At this time, we may change our cipher so that our message is no longer intelligible to intermediate SCs which relay it. We come to terms and arrange delivery. If it is a physical product, delivery may be made through a drop, but most products will be information in one form or another and can be delivered through the SC net. An example might be a program for my automatic micro shaper, which enables it to machine a replacement part for our home flour mill, or even parts for a newer, more capable automatic micro shaper. While a dishonest or unreliable person might join an SC net, he could endanger only his immediate contacts who made the mistake of trusting him. Anyone who used the net to defraud could be cut out of it. Furthermore, his immediate communicants would for a time be considered less reliable. My SC could automatically compute the reliability of intermediaries through which a message comes, as well as selecting alternate routes. Proprietary data, such as a program for my hypothetical automatic microshaper, might be protected from plagiarism by putting individual variations of non-critical dimensions in each part. Payment would most likely be in credits, transmitted through the net to an underground bank. Secure communicators and many other VANU products activities will be developed and used only to the degree that people acquire secure shelter of one form or another, either through outright concealment or by clever deception. SCs can be declared illegal, just as armored cars, firearm silencers, and gold have been. All known abodes and places of business will be subject to inspection, just as they are now. And if an unidentified or unauthorized piece of equipment is found, the bludgy will likely presume that it's contraband unless the occupant proves otherwise. Such laws will be difficult to enforce. SCs can be hidden or disguised, just as gold sometimes is now. But the few violators who are caught will be publicized, and most of those who lack VANU shelter will be sufficiently intimidated to abstain from using gold or secure communicators. So VANU shelter is a crucial prerequisite for substantial VANU trade. From VANU Life number 13, July 1973. Editor's note. Ownership of gold bullion by U.S. citizens was illegal when this article was written. A case for non-coercion based on rational self-interest. The ethical principle of non-coercion can be stated. One should not initiate the use of force against a volitional being or against property created or acquired through voluntary consent. Many people espouse this principle, but most arguments for it are mystical or altruistic. Some are blatantly so. They invoke God's will, or the good of society as a whole. Others are more subtly so, and talk about natural law, or innate rights, without clearly defining those terms. Some supposedly egoistic arguments for non-coercivism are merely reformulations of Kant's categorical imperative and thus mystical. One example: if I deny inviolate rights of all others, I cannot claim such rights for myself. A critic might respond, my recognition of inviolate rights of all others will predictably have only negligible effects on what rights, if any, all others consider inviolate, assuming no God who enforces uniform rights. Another example.
I don't initiate force because I'd rather live in a world where most people don't.
A critic might respond,
I too would prefer such a world, but I have no reason to believe that my conduct will significantly affect the conduct of the world's population.
To base non-coercion on rational self-interest, what must I show? Only that I can expect overall benefits from adopting it, i.e. from espousing, internalizing, and habitually acting in accordance with it. I need not prove that coercion would never be in my self-interest. My decision to embrace or reject an ethical principle is not the same as my decision on action in a particular situation, although the former may decisively affect the latter. An ethical principle is only an abstraction, and like any abstraction, only approximates what it represents. Someone's conception of A is not A. A map is not the territory, but maps and other abstractions are often useful. In rare situations, initiated force may be in one's self-interest, and holding a non-coercive ethic, internalized as a habitual response, will mean loss. But this doesn't prove that adopting the ethic was irrational. Any principle is adopted prior to the situation. The probability of overall benefit or loss, judged at the time of adoption, is what is significant. Similarly, in some automobile accidents, one is more apt to survive, if not encumbered with a safety belt. But this doesn't prove that habitually fastening safety belts is a mistake. Overall probabilities of survival, non-injury, are what count. Most critics of non-coercion ethics espouse situation egoism, which is, hold no general principles except this one. Always act according to self-interest as perceived in the situation at hand. Such a critic might say, "Why encumber yourself with principles? Why build spooks in your head? Why not play it by ear?" In reply, at any time, I can consciously consider only a very small part of what is around me. I must deal with most of my environment through habit and emotion. So the development of generally appropriate habits is to my advantage. If I can walk over ordinary ground without deliberating about each step, I can better think about what is around. An ethical principle, when internalized, becomes habits and attitudes. So the central question of this article reduces to, is developing non-coercive habits and attitudes in my rational self-interest? Consider the alternative, situation egoism. As each situation arises, will I have time to deliberate? To the contrary, most opportunities to coerce are fleeting and require split-second decisions. Zerini and Strykon gave two examples. Number one, you are one of the two astronauts in a spacecraft returning to Earth. Suddenly, you discover that oxygen leaked out. Only enough remains for one man. Number two, you are alone and see a big wad of bills lying beside an unconscious form in a dark alley. If one hesitates, in the first situation, the other astronaut may strike first or barricade himself. In the second situation, the drunk may regain consciousness, or someone else may come. In both situations, one is apt to benefit from coercion if one acts quickly, without deliberation. But even those examples involve many considerations. In the spacecraft, more oxygen might be generated by electrolysis of water, or the men can spend periods in drug-induced coma to reduce oxygen consumption. Even if no alternative to death is immediately apparent, a solution may be found with further thought. Might it not be wiser to chance this, or even to join in some cheat-proof form of Russian roulette, than to face possible revenge by the other man's friends and relatives back on Earth, as well as possible destruction of a craft in a flight? In the second situation, is the drunk still unconscious? Is it a drunk? Might someone be watching from an unseen window? Might it be a trap? perhaps set by non-coercivists to profitably punish or eradicate coercivists. Karate training emphasizes development of appropriate habitual responses. A combatant who tries to think through each move is soon disabled. Similarly, someone who hopes to gain from coercion must not only reject principles, he must train himself to spot opportunities and act quickly, else he miss or bungle them. This is one cost of coercion to the coercer: time, effort, attention, which could otherwise be devoted to other pursuits. A second obvious cost is risk of defense or retribution by the victim or his friends or agents. A third cost to the coercer is ostracism. He is not likely to develop close, long-term relationships with people he finds desirable. Even other coercivists would rather associate between crimes with those who are habitually non-coercive. Even if a coercivist is never caught, even if he never actually commits coercion, but gives subliminal clues to his attitude and habits through gestures, expressions, inflections, mannerisms, and false starts, he may claim to be non-coercive, but in vain. Others will be uneasy when around him and will prefer to avoid him, although they may not always know why. How serious a loss this is depends on his lifestyle and goals. If he prefers to drift around the fringes of big cities, forsaking close friendships, his loss may not be great. But achieving freedom will be very difficult. Freedom through wilderness vanu, international mobility, urban hideaways, and/or black marketeering is enhanced by close, trustworthy confederates. Many freedom achievers are especially sensitive to subliminal indications of attitudes and habits, because their freedom, in part, depends on spotting spies and other security risks. They especially are likely to shun a situation egoist. How big a reward might be offered for information? How much could he rip off? Will he be tempted? Etc. Conceivably, a coercivist might become such a good actor, his friends would never catch on. But this entails the greatest cost of all. He must constantly suppress, inhibit, fake, and live in fear of a slip giving him away. I doubt that he can do this and retain a deep capacity for joy. And without it, his successful rip-offs will be hollow triumphs. Could a band of coercivists avoid these problems by agreeing not to coerce each other, only outsiders? This is often attempted. Every state is such an attempt. But without a general principle of some kind, any agreement is without basis. Some will turn on others the first time they perceive an advantage, and this possibility leads to distrust and sometimes preemptive strikes. I do not claim that adopting non-coercive ethics is in the self-interest of everyone, but I conclude that for myself at least, and probably for those who seek to control their own lives, non-coercivism will maximize efficiency, probable safety, trade opportunities, and emotional capacity. Narrator's note: the footnotes and endnotes will be in the PDF. From Invictus, December 1972. Editor's note: Invictus is no longer being published.
End of section 1. Section 2 will be below.